We're going to continue with some CSS stuff. I'm going to download the files that we had from last time, and we will continue to work on those. I try to balance when I do CSS, you know. I want you to recognize the important concept of it, the notion of a selector. And the selector identifies what gets the style rule. Then there are the attributes, which are the style rule, which says, this I want to look like that. So the background color I want to be green. The text color I want to be white or black or whatever. All right? If you understand that, then there's a couple more things that you need to master. Number one is learning what all those attributes are. And I don't literally mean all of them, because you're never going to learn all of them. There's attributes I don't remember, all right, because there's just so many of them. But the idea is that you can remember the popular ones, the ones that you use all the time, like background. Like, I remember that one forever, right, because I use it all the time. And if you need to, you can then look up some of the details. Like, for example, maybe I want to get rid of the bullet points on the link, all right, or whatever, all right. So we're going to play around with this a little bit more. Again, we're going to revisit this and revisit this. I encourage you to experiment with this. On some of the assignments, we'll have cases where you will create the same HTML with two different CSS files. And that's always fun. It's always fun to see how much different you can make the page look without touching the HTML. All right? So this is what we had last time. This is where we left off last time. And if you remember, I said what really bugs me is the fact that there's a little gap between here. And I couldn't remember the trick to get rid of that. Not that it's really a trick, but we'll do that now, because I think that's important, because I really, really, really don't like that. The trick to get rid of it is this. Whoops. I can just say star and say margin. What that does is that takes away any default margins that the browser has. Because if you look at this, I don't have any code to put any margins in. All my margins are either zero or auto. And therefore, if I say margin zero, it means get rid of all the margins. And the star simply means on every HTML tag that is out there. Make the margin set to zero. So if I do this, then my page looks like that, which is kind of the way I wanted it to. I think it looks a lot better like that. All right. Now, there's another thing I want to do, too, is notice how these letters and stuff are like right up to the edge of the block. I can change that by putting on the same thing, padding 5px, let's say. Now, we'll talk about margin and padding a lot more going forward, but I did want to introduce them to you because a little bit of work with margin and padding can make your page look a lot better and a lot more professional looking. So when I do that, oops. Notice how there's a little bit of space between things. It's not right up to the edge. Unfortunately, those bullets go outside of there. And there's ways to get rid of that, but let's look up one. I'm going to type in Google UL remove bullet points CSS. Getting rid of bullet points from UL. It's sometimes refreshing to know other people have the exact same question that you do. Alright? And the answer is by saying list style type none. So I can go in and say all my ULs on this page I can say list style type none. That will get rid of the bullet points. So that looks a little better. All right.
Can I see that code again?
Sure. UL list style type none. Now, watch this. Let me go in to my lion list. And I'm going to put something kind of silly here, but we have a list of famous lions. What are some famous lions in history?
Richard. That's supposed to be funny.
Oh, Richard the Lionhearted? Okay.
That works.
That works. I'm reaching here. I started down this path with realizing I didn't know any famous lions other than the Detroit Lions. So I'm going to say Richard the Lionhearted. The Detroit Lions. And you know what part of my problem was? I was thinking, well, there's Tony the Tiger. And it's like, well, wait a minute. Tony the Tiger probably isn't a lion. Fortunately, with your contribution and the Detroit Lions and the Cowardly Lion from The Wizard of Oz, we have three, which makes for a nice list. Now, notice this. I got rid of the bullet point on all unordered lists. So will this have bullet points or not? No. Doesn't have bullet points. Now, let's say, and this is true, this list should have bullet points, right? It makes sense for this to be a bulleted list. Whereas this navigation list, I kind of like it without the bulleted points. But remember, with our CSS rule, if we say UL, list style type none, that says every UL on my page has no bullet points. So how do I get around that? How do I make it so only the lists that are in the navigation don't have bullet points? Let me ask this. Which part of the style rule am I going to change? This part or this part? Part one or part two? Part one. Why am I going to change part one? That's correct, by the way.
That's what it's selecting.
Because that's the selector. Remember, the selector says what gets the style rule. So I don't want everything to get the style rule. I just want this unordered list to get that style rule. I don't want this unordered list to get the style rule. So I have to fine-tune my selector. And the way that you do that, there's several ways that we can do that, and we'll talk more about these as the semester goes on, is if I say nav UL. selector means? It means any UL that's inside of a nav gets a style rule. The rest of the style rules, or the rest of the ULs, this rule does not apply to. So if I do this and refresh the page, still stuck with that silly thing of the bullet point being outside of there. There actually is a way to fix that. And I'm going to Google LI position bullet points. And we have a choice of inside or outside. So I can say the style type should take care of the problem. All right, there we go. Put it inside there. Now, let's make sure we understand what's going on here. This first UL applies to every UL on the page. So every UL on the page, by the UL in the footer, by the UL in the header, by the UL in the nav, this style rule applies. This style rule applies to only the ULs that are in the navigation section. If there's two rules for a particular element, the more specific one takes precedence. All right. So in this case, the nav UL applies for the navigation. The other one, all the other ULs get this one. We'll see a few examples, and I think we've already seen an example of using an ID or an example of using a class. That will be the next two things that we'll investigate. It's just a way of fine-tuning our selectors. To say, we don't want everything on the page to work this way. We want certain things, maybe within certain sections, or a certain link we want to look different, or whatever. So, as we learn more style rules, we'll learn more ways to select, and we'll learn more ways, more different attributes that we can control. Now, yes, go ahead.
This is a little bit when sure. I was screwing around with CSS my last lab, I was trying to make the background color different than white. But when I was using that, I noticed that like the background that was directly like with the text, it stayed white while the rest of it had color. Does that make sense? Like, just the parts where there was text, the background was still white. But then any like space in between
section.
Those
were sections. I mean, like H2, like that might be the H2 background.
Yeah.
I mean, am I right?
That could be. It would be very difficult to tell without seeing the code.
Yeah.
If you have an example, if you can recreate it in lab, I'll take a look at it.
Okay.
Probably what happened is it was something to do with your selectors. You had a selector, maybe not where you thought you had, or maybe you had a different color for the sections or paragraphs or whatever. So we'd have to take a look to see exactly what's going on there. Now, a student after class on, when else do we meet? Tuesday? Mentioned that they prefer to line up their style rules like this, where you put each one on their own line. don't do this for all of them, but just to give you the idea. See what I'm doing? I'm putting each pair of attributes on its own line. And you're welcome to do that. If you think that makes it more clear, that's fine. It is. It is good. The other thing that they mention is I actually can do this. Notice how section, article, and aside and footer all have the same style rule. I could actually separate them by commas if I wanted. Assuming I can type. I can do that. And the comma selector says this and that and that and that. Alright. So again, this, like anything that you do, you know, there's several approaches that you can take. And the idea is to make it the way that you think is more readable. Or whatever you think works better for you, is easier for you to understand. So if you have a different style rule for each one, or you put them all on the same line or on different lines, all those things, are personal preference, whichever one you would prefer. It is good to make sure that you see a couple different styles of coding. I try to do that in the class, just because if you're working on a project that someone else has worked on, they may have a different coding style than you do, right? And therefore, you shouldn't be thrown if their code looks a little different than yours. All right? So if we look at this again, it should still look exactly the same, except it doesn't, because I probably forgot article in here. I had that nagging feeling I was forgetting something, and there we go. We'll do a couple more things on this before we move on. Again, I don't want to overwhelm you with CSS stuff. I want to give you some ideas, and I want to point out that, you know, this will literally allows you to style every visual part of the page that you want. For example, if I don't like the font that I'm using on this page, all right? By default, the font on most browsers is Times New Roman, or at least on Windows machines. I can go in and I can put something like this, again with the star, make the default for everything, font family, and I can say something like Arial, Helvetica, sans serif. I'll talk about what this means and why we have three choices here. Alright, let's go and see the difference that this makes. I'll change the font to it. Alright. Okay. Couple of things. Why do we have three fonts listed here? Why do I say font family and have three fonts? Why not just put one font there? Yes?
So if one PC doesn't have the font, then it'll use the other one.
Exactly. Fonts are loaded on machines. Not every machine has the same fonts. It depends on, you know, how old the machine is, what kind of machine it is, so on and so forth. Arial, for example, is found on most Microsoft machines. Helvetica is found on Macs. So right there, I've taken care of Macs and PCs. All right. Arial, in fact, was a font that was created to imitate Helvetica because Microsoft didn't want to pay for the rights to Helvetica. All right. So they cheated and they copied it. All right. So the way the font works is your browser will go down and look, starting with the first one, boom, boom, until it finds a font that your machine has. All right? So usually you supply a list, and usually it's a list of three. And again, typically you have a Windows font, you have a you might have a Mac font. The last one isn't a specific font, but it's a font family. And sans serif is a font family to which both Arial and Helvetica belong. Sans, if I remember from my 2 years of high school French, is French for without. All right? So sans serif means without a serif. Okay? Well, that really doesn't tell us much, right? What is a serif when we talk about fonts? Let me open up Word. So we could look at a whole bunch of fonts here. All right, go ahead.
Doesn't it mean like without the foot?
Yeah, without the foot, without the little thingy. A foot is a good way to put it, except, you know, sometimes the foot isn't always on the bottom.
Right.
It's on the bottom sometimes, but not always. So here is an A in Arial, which is a sans serif font. Here is an A in Times New Roman. Which is a popular serif font. Now in this case, notice that you're absolutely right in describing it as a foot, because it's down here. But if we looked at, let's say, the letter C, it's also up here. Or if I put the letter C in sans serif font, there's no little thingy. So I don't know. And apparently no one else knew another word for it, so they came up with the word serif. So this right here is a serif. This is a serif. This is a serif. So this is a serif font. This is a sans serif font. All right? So that's the two main kinds of font family. The third kind of font family is sometimes called decorative fonts, or the name that I use for those is I Am Never Going to Use You font, all right? Because I don't particularly like them. But they do come in handy in some cases. So all these kind of funky, like, script, looks like handwriting, those I would describe as decorative fonts, you know. And in my humble opinion, they have very limited use on web pages. There are cases when you might want to use them, right? For example, you know, Coca-Cola's logo has a very stylized looking script that's instantly recognizable. Well, okay, yeah, you would use that for the banner that says Coca-Cola on the website. But in ordinary cases, you generally would avoid these, except under some very special circumstances. Keep that in mind when we talk about web design, which probably will be in a few minutes here. All right. At any rate, getting back to the discussion of the fonts, the way this works is it will go down the list until it finds a font that it has. This is kind of like the fail-safe font. In other words, every browser has a default sans serif font. So if you're running some obscure distribution of Linux that neither has Arial nor has Helvetica, it will have a generic sans serif font. And so it won't load Arial, won't load Helvetica, it will load the generic sans serif font. All right. What's the impact of this as far as readability goes? Generally speaking, for smaller text, like text of the paragraphs and so on, sans serif font is usually a little bit more readable. For larger headlines, you can go either way. If you think about fonts, it's sort of like colors. You don't want to mix 100 different fonts on your page, otherwise your page will look like a ransom note, right? You want to use different fonts in a way that will highlight and draw attention to the different stuff on the page. Just like you wouldn't use 100 different colors on the page. Notice in this case we're using 4 or 5 different colors, 3 or 4 if you disregard white and black. All right, so we're not going overkill with the colors. Now we can mix them, so we could do something like this in our CSS. We could make H1s and H2s have a font family of Garamond. Let's find another nice serif font. So this is Garamond. Or Georgia. And that will make the headlines be in the serif font, and that will make the plain text in a different font. CSS, I encourage you to experiment. If some of the things I did are a little confusing, just remember the basic form of these. Oops, wrong file. Selector says what gets the rule. These attributes, or the name of an attribute and the value for the attribute, says how we want to change the page. I'd like to do one more thing, and that is put a background image on the page. You got to be careful with background images, all right, for a few different things, a few different reasons. But I'm going to go out and Google background tiles. Here's a neat little thing that's a pattern generator. It actually allows me to generate a little image. Let's look for patterns instead. Here's a pattern gallery. We have a lot of... pick one that I like. Let's pick the Brady Bunch one. Here we go. Oh, let's see. What do I like? I'll pick this one. Review the image. Save the image as Panner.jpg. Alright. I'm going to copy the name of this. Because I want to put that in my footer. I want to be responsible and give credit to where I found this image. I'm able to do this because this is an educational context. You couldn't simply do this unless the copyright holder gave you explicit permission. Now, if I go to that site, it might say, hey, you can use this if you're a nonprofit organization or for personal use. But if you're a corporation, a for-profit corporation, then you have to pay a certain fee or whatever. So I'm going to put in here pattern you up from here. I'm going to save that. And then, remember, we're still working on everything being in the same folder. So I'm going to put that tile into here. Now, I'm going to go in my CSS, and I can use a background image. Where it says background, instead of putting a color here, I can put URL, parentheses, the name of the file, quote, parentheses, and if I save that, then that becomes the background for my entire page. I don't know if that's a good choice or not. I mean, I didn't want to spend hours looking for the perfect pattern. You did see there are pattern generators where you can make your own pattern and so on. Now notice a couple things. Notice a pattern that's only this big, yet it covers the whole screen. It does that by tiling it. Tiling it, like if you ever put in tile like in your bathroom or on a floor or on a wall, you know, you get a certain pattern so that when you lay them next to each other, the patterns sort of interlock and form one big pattern. Alright, so that's the same thing that's going on here. Alright? So you can make background images. And this is a good effect to do. Alright? Again, I don't know if this particular tile is good, but, you know, hey, we'll stick with it. Alright? It's good because notice it doesn't get in the way of any of the text. Alright? Doesn't get in the way of any of the text. You can also use a background image without this. So, like, let me cut out this style rule. Temporarily. The problem is if you're not real careful and you have a background image, the text is going to be very hard to read against it. You'd have to make sure that the color of text that you used was something that was readable. So in this case, maybe I'll say that the color, instead of being that green, is black. That makes it a little easier to read, but it's still not really good to read. Alright? So, background images are good, and they're effective, but you don't want to make them such that they get in the way of the text. Obviously. And one way you can do that is do this, where you sort of have your background image almost serve the purpose of a frame, alright, and you have your content in sort of a middle section that has a different background color and doesn't use a background image. Now you can use a background image for any element of your page, alright, so for example, I could do this. I could put my H1s and H2s have the background pattern. Then only the H1s and H2s have the background pattern. And that actually isn't bad Except Lines is a little hard to read up against it, and Famous Lines is a little hard to read. So if I set those to white, that would make it a little more doable. And in fact, I'm going to do that. So I kind of like this. Bottom line is you can set a background image for your entire page, or you can set it for just parts of the page. You don't have to use a tile like this. You could actually find a really nice, big, giant image. Let's go in Google and search for a really good zoo animal picture. So I'm going to search for zoo animal. Alright, now I'm going to use advanced search because I want this to be a big image. So I'm going to say size, large. Then I'm going to go for usage rights. Now, usage rights is a way that even if you are a business, you can reuse it. Alright? Some people license their images by what's called a Creative Commons license. And what that means is they're giving people permission in advance to use their images for whatever they want to. Now, there's several levels of that. The labeled for non-commercial reuse means that if I'm a nonprofit organization or a personal website, I could use this. Non-commercial with modification means I can use it and I'm allowed to change it. Labeled for reuse means that I can use it, but I'm not allowed to change it. The most flexible at all is labeled for reuse with modification, which means I can use it and I can also alter it. So I'm going to go and search for that. And, whoops, here's a list of the pages that are available. I like this one. Well, that's not going to show up good, though, because the giraffe's face is going to be off to the side. I don't know. Let's take this one. Again, I'm going to take a copy of it. I'm going to put it in here. I'm going to go back here and give credit on my page. And I'm going to go here and say, whoops, I didn't mean to do that. You see, it's a gigantic image, so actually, we've only seen some of the fur. I don't know, I kind of like that, right? The one thing about that is this is a very big image, so it will take longer to download. Now, concern about the download of images is always going to be a concern in web development. Although these days, download speeds are a lot faster than they used to be. Let me go and make it smaller. I am going to not follow, since it's on the web, I'm not going to follow my rule of making a copy of it. Actually, I will. Practice what you preach. So I'll copy it and put it on the desktop. And I'll make a smaller version of it. I don't know if this is going to be much better, but we'll see. A little bit better, maybe. Yeah, it's kind of cool how that works. Now, again, you don't have to, you know, if you had the text right on top of that image, some of the text might be harder to read. All right, so that's something you definitely can be concerned about. One thing that you can do, especially if you have available an image editing program, is you can sort of fade the image like a watermark, all right? By adjusting the contrast and the brightness of it, you can sort of make it like, you've all seen watermarks like on checks or documents where you can see something in the background, but it's not like very prominent, it's just very subtle. Well, you can do that with this too, and that's another effective way. The other thing that you can do is that's kind of cool, that we're not gonna do today, but it would be a good exercise if you wanted to, is you can set up transparency on a web page. In other words, I could make, right now, this is what's called opaque. In other words, it's solid. That green is solid, which means you can't see the picture behind it. You can set it up to be like, say, for example, 50% transparent. So you see the image behind it, but you see it like sort of through like a colored glass, if you will. You know, or like cellophane, you know, colored cellophane, where you can see behind it. But if I made that white, it would be like a very, very faint white background. And that will help you read the text while still sort of showing the image behind it. We'll probably do an example of that at some point throughout the semester. We could do this endlessly, and I don't want to play all my cards right now and talk everything I know about CSS. We'll do this throughout the semester. But I wanted to show you just how with just a little bit of CSS, you can really take a page that originally was very, very bland and make it look a lot closer to a professional looking page. Again, if I was doing this for real, there's some things I probably wouldn't do. I kind of like this background for that. But I might make the fonts a little bigger and a little heavier to make it a little easier to read some of these, all right? And I probably wouldn't go with the big leopard image in the background, at least not unless I made the rest of the area transparent. All right, we're learning a lot of stuff about CSS, all right? As someone told Spider-Man, or maybe Spider-Man told someone, with, I don't know, I'm not really a comic book fan. I watch the movies once in a while, but someone says something to the effect of, with great power comes great responsibility. All right? We're learning with CSS how to change everything on the web page. So we could make everything on the web page a different color. Well, your responsibility of a web designer is not to do that. All right? We technically know how to do that. We technically know how to make every tag on the page a different color. What more, we know how to make different tags within different sections different colors. So we really could make a mess out of this web page if we wanted to. All right? It's our responsibility not to, however. And that's where design comes in. Design isn't just about picking nice colors. It's about what you're doing visually to help your users understand the content of the page. All right? That's what design is about. Now, we could say, for example, we put that there because, yeah, that's kind of a cool pattern. Maybe that's what the sidewalk looks like in the zoo. I don't know. Yeah, so we did it. It makes it more visually appealing, let's say. But, more importantly, it makes that heading stand out from the rest of the stuff. Likewise, this being a different color than that makes this stand out a little bit more. The hover effect makes it clear that we're looking at a link. All right? So we're not just doing these style things just for the appearance. We're doing these style things to make the page more usable. And that's where web design comes in. Our next topic is going to be, now that we've talked technically about what we can do with CSS and HTML, we're going to sort of go back and say, design-wise, what are we going to do to make a well-designed web page? And what I'd like you to do, and your next lab is going to have something to do with it, is make a web page that contains, identify a couple pages that you think are well-designed and some pages that are poorly designed. And Tuesday, I'd like to discuss some of those. You know, which pages do you pick? What page do you think is well-designed? Why do you think it's well-designed? So I'd like to have that discussion. On the flip side, which is actually more fun, find some bad pages. Because it's fun talking about bad web pages. It's fun to see these pages with all these different colors, provided you don't have to actually use them. All right? So we will talk about good and bad web pages, what makes them good and bad, and we'll then go and sort of dovetail into a discussion of your project and what you need to do to design your project. All right, any questions? I will go ahead.
On the margin in the CSS, you did a global margin.
Yes.
So throughout the rest of the page, could you remove the margins?
In fact, I did that, like, for example, here. On the section and all that, I put a margin that overrules it. All right, a margin of auto. And what that does is that centers it. So yes, I overwrote it. Or I could do something like this. I could put 10 pixels in for the margin. And that's going to leave a little gap between stuff. Actually, now that we have the cheetah in the background, that little gap probably isn't so bad. It's just the blank white space. But yes, you can put a global margin and then you override it. And in which one takes precedence? The more specific you define a rule, it takes precedence over the more generic default.
Now, why didn't the global cause those white spaces to disappear?
The global did cause the white spaces to disappear.
Why do you need it twice?
Why do I need what twice?
Margin 0 pix auto?
Well, because, good question. We'll talk more about this when we talk about margins, but remember, margins exist in four directions. There's a top margin, there's a right margin, there's a bottom margin, and a left margin. If I want to override the margin on the generic, I want to override only the right and left. I want to make the right and left automatic. That is, I want to center. I want to automatically make those right and left margins center. The top and the bottom, I want to keep at 0px. So I say 0px on the top, auto on the right, 0px on the bottom, auto on the left. It's like you're going around like a clock. Setting the top, right, left. I mean, I could put 4 there and put a top margin, a bottom margin, and a right margin. If I only put 2 of them, the first one is for the top and bottom, the second one is for the right and left.
Okay.
We can play around with that in lab.
Yeah, I don't want to keep people.
Okay. All right. Other questions? All right. I will come and get the...